Promise ye, devils and demons, this is Nurse Hatchet. You are listening to the Wolf Pack.
The genre of horror is a great expanse.
Great expanse.
We want to explore it. We've spent years building our credibility, our reputation, interviewing people from all levels of horror, discussing visual and literary horror. This is our exploration. This is
Full Spectrum Horror.
What an excellent day for an exorcism. Hello, everyone, and welcome to another episode of Full Spectrum Horror. I am your host, Mr. Christopher Highland, and with me, as always, is, let's see, who is he this time? Oh, yes, is he the Pope or is he Grizzly Adams? Say hello, Grizzly.
Well, hello, Tree. How are you doing? And, you know, how are you handling all this? Because you know how much fun it is to be stuck in the house all day and, you know, having to sit there and watch Zach Baggins all day. You know, it's just absolutely thrilling me to death. Gorin scares everybody. It's me.
Yes, Grizzly Pope.
No. William Pattison, a.k.a. Eric Morse, the King of Splatterpunk. Right here, you know, with my dear old beard and, you know, wearing my Coke and polar bear joggers and my dirty tank top. You know, just having a, you know, going the full quarantine fashion look. How about you, Mr. Highland? What are you sporting this evening?
Simpsons shirt with Ralph Wiggum saying, I bit my Wookiee.
Okay. So you're exciting. Okay, ladies, you know, hold yourself back, you know, it's just incredible. You know, you got these two foxy gentlemen here.
And I have a little beard again, and before the lockdown I had to get a buzz cut because my hair was looking like I was Methuselah.
Oh my God, so you're no longer horror Jesus anymore?
Not right now.
No, now you're ZZ Top. Beard with a head or something. Look like a biker. Okay. So I know you're absolutely just grinding at the bit for your favorite segment of the show, so I'll get into it for you.
Oh, we're going to do that now?
Yes, of course we're going to do fan mail for you.
Oh, first. Okay.
Of course we always do that because, you know, we love our fans and we love our fan mail, and you know, with some of you out there, it's the only thing that you can do. So, you know, can you believe my mail has doubled now that we're in quarantine because we've got so many wonderful human beings out there sending me letters.
Oh.
Yeah, some of them really, you know, they shouldn't be using a keyboard. They should be using a crayon. God. You know, and the thing is, I really do need better, you know, come on, people. I need better cyber stalkers. I mean, the ones I have right now are just, oh, my God. You know, Mr.
Korean, complete with backwards letters. It just reminded me. Yeah. It just reminded me. Spellings. It just reminded me of my idea for the Kindergarten Cop 2 marketing. They should have just wrote it in backwards, in crayon and with backwards letters, and just called it the tumor.
Nice.
People would have understood what it was, you know, referencing. Like, oh, what's the tumor? Like, oh, I understand now.
Yeah, well, this one idiot cyber stalker of mine. Oh my God, Mr. Highland, I am. Oh God, the one that works at the porno shop.
Mm-hmm.
Oh my God, he sent me about 2 pages worth of a rant, and he didn't break it up into paragraphs.
Oh my God! What?
So it was one huge ass 2-page block of him ranting and misspelling, and that I felt like pulling out the red pencil and sending it back to him.
He's probably constantly typing to the point where the keyboard and his fingers were smoking.
Oh my God, yeah. You know, I mean, seriously, Sylvester the cat from Talking Kitty actually writes better than this guy. And then, of course, I've got the other one that looks like Todd from Talking Kitty, you know, the one with the big old long beard and the long hair and the missing teeth. Oh, God. You know, come on, people. We've got to have better cyber stalkers than that. I mean, I've got a reputation to, you know, go for. I mean, you know, really. But anyways, you know, let's get to our fan mail. Yeah, I mean, I literally had to go through about 200 letters to get these 5 fan letters for us. Ugh. That and the fact that these asshole cyber stalkers have signed me up for all these, you know, I've got Kissable Karen sending me emails. You know, and just all these different porno sites. It's like ridiculous. Anyways, here we go. Fan mail, because Mr. Highland loves it. All right. This is from Carl from Redding, California. He said, I wanted to ask both of you, who is your favorite horror host?
I don't have one.
You don't have one?
No.
Yeah, that's the problem. I have a number of favorite horror hosts. That's the problem, you know, because they're all, you know, just so wonderful. I mean, you know, of course, you know, we have to salute Elvira, Mistress of the Dark.
Yeah.
Yes, she's top flight. You know, my dear friend Al Omega from Creature Features. Vince Van Dahl from the other Creature Features. The Ghoul. I like him. And Mr. Lobo, you know, our very own Criswell, he is very good as well. So there you go, Carl. There's your answer from Redding, California. I think you'll agree too, because you're from Redding, so you know pretty much all of them. You probably watch all of them. Alrighty. This is from Eric from San Jose. Hey guys, I wanted to find out if either of you have gotten the coronavirus. Sticking at home. What have you done with your free time while locked up? No, I don't believe either. I haven't got the coronavirus. You know, I've been very careful. I've been wearing gloves and putting a covering over my face, you know, while outside. And I've got an order in for a nice mask. Mr. Highland, I gather, you know, he goes out quite a bit.
No, not quite a bit. Only for groceries, that's it.
Yeah, well, I don't think you putting on your clown makeup and putting your rubber shoes on is going to keep you from the coronavirus, Mr. Highland. But who knows? You know, and what have we been doing with our free time while locked up?
Reading a lot, watching a lot of stuff. Right now, I'm watching Dark Shadows.
Okay.
I'm preparing for our season finale. And I hope you are too, Eric. Let's see.
Yes. Well, you know how I set up, you know, how I do these things. So, mm-hmm. You know, and I mean, it's a few months away. I know I don't have to do it right now because I've got a lot of other things I need to do. But anyways, yeah, I have been doing a little bit of research, little bit. I'm not going to be doing questions like you keep pushing at me. You know, you got your questions. I don't do questions. I will talk about the subject, yes, but don't do questions. Anyways, as for myself, let me see. I went through 6 seasons of The Clone Wars. I'm currently watching Star Wars Rebels. I have Star Wars Resistance in the queue. I finished watching Picard. I've been watching a bunch of horror movies, and I've been listening to a few audiobooks.
Yeah, so
I just finished listening to Richard Matheson's I Am Legend. Wonderful. And I'm currently listening to Star Wars Galaxy Edge Black Spire. It's wonderful so far. It's the backstory to Star Wars Galaxy Edge, you know, the park over at Disney, which we hope will come back once the coronavirus pandemic's over. But we'll see. And on top of that, I've been, doing some little bit of work on Symphony of Death Part 5. You know, I'm working out some of the details for the first prologue for the prologue story for that one. It's going to be a neat little story. It's one of the few that solely takes place in hell. And it's titled Smile. And I know Mr. Highland's going to be thrilled because I'm having him beta read it. So it's going to be interesting seeing what his opinion is on it. Alrighty, besides that, taking care of my sister, which is my job, I'm her at-home care person. So that's how I get my pay besides writing. Cleaning, doing all kinds of different stuff. I've been enjoying my friend Felicia Day. She keeps putting out a vlog on how she's going through her quarantine. So those are always entertaining. Okay. So, anyways, so that's what I've been doing. I've been trying to keep myself busy because, I don't want to be like the rest of my family, which are suffering from cabin fever and have been driving me nuts. Alrighty, so there's your answer there, Eric from San Jose. Next one is John from New York City. I want to wish you both a happy Artists in Horror Month and say I appreciate you both. Well, thank you, John. We got that in a little bit late, but it's still good. Artists in Horror Month was in March. But, I accept it. How about you, Mr. Highland?
Yes, thank you.
Alrighty, and here we go. Here's our last one. And I don't know where these people come from. But anyways, this is Jose from Redwood City, California. Actually, I do know they come from Redwood City, California. I think other people have asked this, but I wanted to know who is the boss of the show. I know that opens the show, but it seems like William says when the segments start. It seems like William runs the show. I'm sorry if I caused an issue. Okay, Mr. Highland, answer the thing.
I wouldn't say there's a boss on the show. I mean, we each do our parts, and whether it's equal or one outweighs the other, it happens. But I wouldn't say there's a boss. Even though I come up with the topics and I book guests and let's see, what else do I do? Oh yeah, I pick music. Let's see, what else goes on?
So, that's the honest answer. Neither one of us, though, we know who the boss of the show is. That's Mr. Highland. Of course you are, Mr. Highland. Everyone knows who the boss is. Yes. Right.
Oh, thanks, Katie.
Okay, well, Okay, so that's solved. Thank you, Jose, for that. Alrighty, now it is time for horror news. Yes, Mr. Highland has spent the entire month, going all over the internet looking for that weird, that strange, that horror news. So there you go, Mr. Highland. There's your introduction.
Yes, and unfortunately, with current events going on, I wasn't able to get much. And okay, I've had a lot of technical difficulties right now. So, in no particular order. And this was rather a surprise. This is a rather obscure book, but anyone who's familiar with the movie Halloween 3 will know this book. The Eagle's Gift by Carlos Castaneda. This will finally be an audible book. And from the description, this is about sorcery and So, unfortunately, this will not be an audible book until February 1st of next year. So, you're going to have to wait until then. And this next book, this is out right now, Wolf Tracks by David Case. If you can't guess, that's a book about werewolves, or a werewolf. And next, I should say last, but certainly not the least, the novel Stage Fright by Garrett Boatman, that will be reprinted by Valancourt sometime in the summer. And that one I'm interested in very much from the description alone. Sorry, I don't have it up for me, but take it from me. It's exciting, and if they ever made a movie out of it, it would be popular. So that's all I have. How about you?
Alrighty, now it is time for us to bring you some cool shit from the King of Splatterpunk here. Alrighty, I got the memorabilia and the shirts and all the good stuff for you. Alrighty, first off, Big Herc Collections is making high-top canvas shoes featuring Toxic Crusaders, the 1991 animated series based on the Toxic Avenger. They're $60, limited to 250. Each pair comes in a hand-numbered shoe box and includes black and toxic green shoelaces. They're scheduled to go into production on April 21st. So put in your order for those. Whether you feel like the May Queen or Summertime Sadness, Nacho Senko has the Midsummer hard enamel pin for you. Each design is limited to 50 and costs $14. Get your Friday fix of thrills, chills, and kills with Fright Rags' new t-shirt for Shockwaves, a very well-known podcast. Designed by Kyle Crawford, it costs $28 and comes in unisex and women's styles. A second shirt featuring the Shockwaves logo by Aaron Crawford is also available for $28. The day has come for Cavity Colors Day of the Dead apparel. Leading the collection is a Devin Whitehead design on t-shirts for $27, lady tank tops for $27, baseball tees for $37, and zip-up hoodies for $48. The line also includes a yellow shirt designed by Austin Harden for $27, a pocket tee designed by Hillary White for $27, and I know Mr. Highland is definitely going to go after this, a Bub enamel pin designed by Nacho Sacho himself for $12. Alrighty, getting out of the t-shirts and stuff, we have Friday the 13th, the horror at Camp Crystal Lake game will be released this summer via the OP Games. The survival board game will carry a $29.99 retail price. 3 to 6 players take on the roles of stereotype camp counselors, the nerd, the jock, the partier, the nice guy, the diva, and the final girl, and try to get through 5 nights of being terrorized by Jason Voorhees. Strategy and supplies are your tools for survival. The game also includes the cabin board, 6-player board, 6-player tokens, 6-player escape tokens, 67 supply tokens, 88 blood splatter tokens, 6 backpack cards, 10 critical supply cards, 64 fear cards, 1 night tracker, and 1 camp bag, and of course, you know, no game is complete without a rule book. Okay, back into apparel. April Fool's Day is no joke with Fright Rags parody designs by Abrar Amel. Fright Night in the style of Saturday Night Fever, Silver Bullet in the style of Purple Rain, and Christine in the style of Back to the Future are available on t-shirts for $28 and zip-up hoodies for $48. I could see Mr. Highland getting the Christine style Back to the Future. What do you say, Mr.
Highland? Yes.
And finally, Matthew Skiff has the Terminator and Terminator 2 Judgment Day screen prints on rainbow foil. Each poster measures 18 by 24 and costs $50. Terminator is limited to 8, while Terminator 2 is an edition of 10. So that's it for my horror news. Now it is time for Screen Factory. I know Mr. Highland is all excited. Oh, yeah. Yeah, we got We got one of your favorite films starting out here.
Oh, what?
All righty, Hammer Classic.
What?
We got Frankenstein and the Monster from Hell. 23.99. And so let's check out the synopsis. The film belongs to Peter Cushing and as such is a perfect swan song for his greatest creation. British Horror Films dot C-O-U-K. Is Baron Frankenstein truly dead? That's precisely what he wants the world to think. He's had it up to there with a public that doesn't appreciate the trouble a mad scientist goes through to snatch body parts. To carry on his work, he holes up in a place where the possibilities are utterly maddening. A home for the criminally insane. A hand here, a brain there, true to form. The Baron, played by Peter Cushing, keeps his gruesome creation, played by David Prowse, known for his portrayal of Darth Vader, in stitches in this sixth and final Fright Fest in the Hammer Films Frankenstein cycle. Yeah, that one I wasn't too thrilled with myself. No, I don't know how Mr. Highland feels about it.
Been too long.
Okay, here's another one. I know this one you love.
What?
You know, because you're also a Free Willy fan.
What?
Yeah, this is the horror version of Free Willy. The Killer Whale by Dino De Laurentiis. For $22.99.
Oh, I know what movie you're talking about. Come on, say it.
Man and killer whale clash in a fight to the death. Sleek, intelligent, beautiful, hell-bent on revenge, producer Dino De Laurentiis, King Kong and Ragtime, and director Michael Anderson, Around the World in 80 Days and Logan's Run, joined forces to present the rousing action-adventure tale of Orca, the whale. It's the story of one powerful being against another, a strong, determined fisherman, played by Richard Harris, versus an equally determined killer whale. When the giant whale's pregnant mate is maimed and killed by Harris, the whale seeks vengeance, smashing boats, attacking a seacoast village, and eventually luring his human adversary to a final confrontation in the marine creature's own Arctic turf. Charlotte Rampling, Will Simpson, and Bo Derek in her feature film debut also stars in this seafaring epic, brimming with nail-biting suspension spectacular special effects. Yep, I know Mr. Highland's going to go for that. You know, he's going to have that with his Free Willy collection.
Oh, come on. Richard Harris has done better work. I mean, in the 70s, it seems like he was in everything. But that's not a bad thing. I mean, he's done a lot of good work. The last movie I saw him in was, I think it was called Juggernaut, where he was part of this team of bomb-disarming people.
Uh-huh.
You know that one?
No, I don't, but...
It's a good one. It takes place aboard a cruise ship, and a series of bombs on it, and he has to go on and get onto the ship and disarm the bombs.
All right, and oh good, we're going for 3 here. Another film Mr. Highland will absolutely love. The Spider for $22.99. Because I know you like bug movies.
I do.
8 Legs of Terror. Moviegoers had already been exposed to giant ants and a man turned half fly when the spider creeped onto movie theater screens. Producer, writer, special effects supervisor Bert I. Gordon was just the man to bring this giant arachnid to the screen, having frightened moviegoers with films like Attack of the Puppet People and The Amazing Colossal Man. Quiet River Falls is the town awakened by the insect's devastating rampage. 2 teens discover the monster, see it temporarily disabled by gas, and then watch in terror as it unfolds its 8 legs of doom. Will our heroes survive? Will the entire town fall prey of this unstoppable fanged horror? Yep, that sounds like your type of movie. All righty, and we got one for me. Because I've got this in my collection and I love it.
Oh, but...
The Hills Run Red for $22.99. You ever heard of that one, Mr. Highland?
Yes.
Yeah. You heard the story. The one about the goriest, bloodiest splatter flick ever. The one that made... One made in the 80s, but obviously lost. Flash forward to now. Young cinema buffs search for the secret location where the movie was shot, hoping to find the film. What they find is that the goriest, bloodiest splatter flick ever is more than a movie. It's real. It's happening to them. Hills Run Red faults into a whole new level of horror as the terrified interlopers confront a demented killer who covers his hacked up face with a doll, baby doll mask. Wait, Babyface is just a character from a movie, right? Wrong, he's alive. He's waiting. He's thrilled to meet fans who will die slowly, gruesomely, shockingly for his art. Get ready to meet a new horror icon, Babyface. Yep, love that film. Thing is that Debbie Rochon did a film with another Babyface killer, and that one was a joke. You know, sorry, D-Ro, but yeah, I absolutely, that one was horrid. All right, oh, here's another one for our horror history buff, Mr. Highland. For $55.97, Universal Horror Collection, Volume 5. Let's see. Get ready for more thrills and chills. Volume 5 of the Universal Horror Collection includes 4 tales of terror from the archives of Universal Pictures, the true home of classic horror. A mobster's brain is transplanted into an ape who carries out his revenge in The Monster and the Girl. A mad scientist turns an ape into a beautiful but deadly woman in Captive Wild Woman. Jungle Woman, the sequel to Captive Wild Woman, is an eerie thriller with an all the danger of wild animals on the loose and a sexy killer on the prowl. And in Jungle Captive, a scientist has experimented on reanimating animals, but now he has decided to go one step further and reanimate a human. That sounds like something you'd love. Huh, Mr. Highland?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and here we go. Final one. This one sounds like a real winner. The Blackout, Invasion Earth for $15.99. It's on DVD, so you can watch it, Mr. Highland. Someone or something is plunging humanity into darkness. When the end comes for civilization, it will be terrorism or nuclear war that causes it. No, it will be the blackout. An unexplained phenomena has struck the Earth. Contact between most towns on Earth has been severed. A small area of the Eastern Europe is the only location that still has electricity. When military forces venture outside, they discover a shocking truth. Corpses everywhere. In stores, in cars, in roads, in hospitals, in railway stations. Who or what is destroying all life on Earth? And how long can the last outpost of humanity endure? Wow. Sounds like something, huh?
Mm-hmm.
Alrighty, so that is it for Shock Factory for this month. And now it is time for movie reviews.
Yes, and again, I only have just one. But this is a movie that I've wanted to see for quite some time, and I'm glad that it was finally adapted, because this is from a script that was written in the 80s, and it wasn't able to get made until it was a couple of years ago. And okay, this is called Johnny Gruesome. And luckily I was able to see it online. It's about this high schooler named Johnny Grissom, but everyone calls him Johnny Gruesome. And you know, he's this typical you know, he has long hair and wears black all the time, and anyway, he gets into a fight when he gets to school, and he goes to the principal's office and he gets suspended for a week. And not long after that, he's driving around in his car with his friends, and he's driving drunk. And he's speeding, and he almost goes off a bridge, but his girlfriend pulls the emergency brake and stops, and one of his friends puts him in a chokehold, and that ends up killing him. And they have to, I don't want to say dump the body, but they have to put the body back in the car and dump it off the bridge. So everyone thinks that, oh, he got into a car accident and drowned, but no, that's not it. He ends up climbing out of his grave, and when I saw that, it was rather comical. I mean, the first part of the movie, first half, I mean, there's little nuggets of humor here and there. And this is one of them. In the foreground, you see Undertakers, the people who dig up the ditch diggers, that's it. You see them in the foreground talking to each other, and they don't even notice Johnny walking past them. So he's shaking himself off from all the dirt. And then after that, he basically kills all the people that wronged him, starting out with the guy who he got in the fight with at the beginning of the movie. Unfortunately, you don't see the death scenes. You see the aftermaths of them, and at least some of them are humorous. I don't know if the writer was going for that or not, but that's what happened. The second half of the film is not really as comical. What else can I say about this? It has a low budget feel. So unfortunately, if it had a better budget, it might have had a better overall effect. It's not really that scary. I would say it's nearly decent, but it's entertaining enough. For a rating, I would give this a 2.5 out of 5.
Skulls, right?
It's worth a look, but it's not a classic.
Okay, and you did realize that it's based on an underground comic.
Comic?
Yeah.
Don't you mean a novel? The script was novelized.
Yeah, that's what I meant. Well, it's also a comic, too.
Oh, well, that I didn't know.
Oh, yeah. Johnny Gruesome? Oh, yeah.
You're going to have to...
Underground experience.
Yeah, you're going to have to show me.
Yeah. Alrighty, so that was it for yours?
Yeah.
Okay, well, I've got a good one and I've got an okay one. I'll start out with the okay one. What it is it's an anthology film, and you know how much I love anthology films.
Mm-hmm. But
is that anthology films can go good and they can go bad. This one went okay. It's called A Night of Horror Nightmare Radio, and it just came out. And it's about a radio DJ named Rod, who hosts a popular themed radio show where he tells tales of terror for eager listeners. And to what happens is, this is the wraparound story. He begins receiving alarming calls from a horrified child during his radio show. And the thing is, all the stories play out. And what's interesting, Mr. Highland, is that I've seen all the stories in this anthology before. And you're going to find this amusing. All the stories were short films that I watched in 2015 for the Martinsville Horror Fest film festival.
Oh no.
Yeah. So basically what it is that this filmmaker went and took a whole bunch of independent films and slammed them into this wraparound story, and release them. Well, you know, they're actually pretty good stories. I do have to admit, because I've seen some really horrid pieces of crap, and this one is actually fairly good in the fact that all of the stories are of equal quality. And they match in with the quality of the wraparound story. And there's a couple of stories that stood out for me, because, you know, they got high ratings from me at Martinsville Horror Fest. And one's this one about this woman who keeps seeing this white demon creature that's chasing her around her house. And the thing is that what happens is, it turns out that the demon creature is a dream that she's having, and the demon creature, when it attacks her in her bed, she stabs it, and it turns out that she stabbed her husband, her abusive husband. So pretty cool story. There's another one that's sort of you would appreciate it, Mr. Highland. You know, you'd like this one. And you can probably find it on YouTube. It's one about this little girl who keeps, you know, she gets up and she's looking around for her mommy, and she keeps finding these balloons. And she follows the balloons down to the kitchen, and she finds this thing in the kitchen, and it's this white, really creepy looking guy. You know, he's done up in, well, it's like white body paint. You know, they didn't have a lot of money for it. And her mom's sitting behind him. He's killed her, And what he does is he uses her blood and he makes himself up to look like a clown. And it just, it ends abruptly and shockingly when it goes after the kid. Because it's sitting there and it's playing at her. It's going, he puts his eyebrows on, puts a little blood on his nose, wipes some blood across his mouth and a big smiley face. The guy that they got to play that part is creepy as shit. Seriously, they did not use any appliances on his face. All they did is took white makeup all over his body. That was it. And he had like a loincloth on. And that was it. They did up his entire body in white. That was creepy as shit. Anyways, the wraparound story is really good. As I said, it's very atmospheric. And the guy who plays the DJ, Rob Wilson, who's played by James Wright, he does a really good job. So, you know, it's not a great anthology. It's not anything I'm going to go back to. It's not anything I'm going to keep in my collection because it just wasn't worth it. And, you know, honestly, if you want to save some money, you can watch all the segments except for the wraparound story on YouTube, believe it or not, Mr. Highland. Because they're all there. But he's put it out, these ones have put it out as a movie. So I think much like Johnny Gruesome, I'm going to give this one, I'll give it a 3. I'll give it a 3 skulls out of 5 because it was okay. It wasn't horrible. I've seen worse, and I've seen worse done by people who were supposedly, you know, high-ranking horror people. And their stuff is usually, you know, they should go, you know, go for a higher standard, but their stuff is usually crap. And they don't know how to do a wraparound story. This had a good wraparound story. It had good, they chose the stories right because there wasn't a huge difference in styles and color schemes and that. It was very well done. Alrighty, so my next film is another brand new film that's actually still out in theaters. I actually paid to watch it at home because I'd heard some things about it, and I was very happy with what I ended up with. It's a film called Underwater. And if you like The Abyss, if you liked Leviathan and movies like that, you will absolutely love this. An unknown massive earthquake happens in a drilling station at the bottom of the Mariana Trench. And the crew of this drilling platform, they have to get out of there. They have to go all the way down to the bottom of the ground level and go to another station in the water at the bottom of the Marianas Trench. And the thing is, they find out that there's these humanoid creatures around there, and there's another creature which these things come from. And it's huge. I mean, it is Godzilla size huge. And it's the thing that caused the earthquake. And it was a sleeping creature, very Lovecraftian. And the thing is that these people, they're running out of oxygen. They have to get to these pods to escape. And, oh my fucking God, when they reveal the monster, it is awesome. They did some good work on that. For what little budget they had for this film, they did an amazing job on it. Amusingly, Mr. Highland, you're going to love this because you're going to cringe. This film stars Kristen Stewart. You know who Kristen Stewart is, right?
Yeah.
Twilight. Yeah, Twilight. But she does a fantastic job in this. I can forgive her for Twilight. Actually, because of this film. Because she does just such a fantastic job. Now, I looked on IMDb and a lot of people have been talking shit about this film. Honestly, I have to tell people, check it out. It is damn good. The monsters, they use a lot of darkness in this. They use darkness to its advantage. And you catch just images, quick images of the monsters and stuff. And when they are actually revealed, they are frightening as shit. And the big monster, well, should I do a spoiler? Okay, people, close your ears. Only Mr. Highland will hear this. The big monster is none other than Cthulhu. And this is the best representation of Cthulhu I've seen on screen. It is fucking awesome. And just stunning work the budget on this film was shit, and they managed to put it out, and they managed to make it feel horribly claustrophobic. And people were talking about the acting being shit and saying that, the only character you really care about is a little plush bunny that the one character carries. Now, I know Mr. Highland would agree with that. He appreciates little plush bunnies, right? And it's a little plush bunny. But no, I cared about the people and I wanted them to get out of there. And the ending, the twist at the end was really good and all that. And I was very happy with this. I'm going to give this a 4 skulls, definitely. And I'm just telling you guys, check it out. Don't listen to the assholes on IMDb. Check it out. This is a good film to watch while in quarantine. Alrighty, Mr. Highland, it is time yet again for our music break, and Mr. Highland has spent the entire month looking for music, and he drove me nuts. And thank you, and thank you, YouTube, fuck you, for going and blocking the YouTube downloader so I couldn't download the music. So I had to go use a digital voice recorder and sit there and get cramps and hurt my arms.
Is it just YouTube that's doing this, or can...
Yes, it is YouTube. YouTube is blocking people from downloading now. Because it wants you to spend $5 a song. And spend money for movies and shit, for old movies.
I'm sorry, I didn't look elsewhere.
No, that's fine. I mean, it's, but I'm just telling you, that's what YouTube is pulling now. YouTube to you. Anyways, alrighty, so, Mr. Highland worked hard, and I worked incredibly hard to bring you these music pieces, so enjoy, and we'll be back in a few moments.
You broke home and you keep holding on. Communications had customer service agents available 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Well, naturally, I felt we should too.
Thank you for calling Megatelco. This is Balcazar, Prince of Misery and Apprentice to Evil. May I help you?
It's all about serving you better.
They can't. We do. Voice, data, and web for business. XO, not just talk.
She devils and demons, this is Nurse Hatchet, She-Wolf of the Wolf Pack.
Alrighty, so that was our music break. You there, Mr. Highland, or are you still off getting a drink?
Taking a mini nap.
Oh, okay. Yeah, it's yeah. Well, I had to go use the little boy's room because I've been drinking water heavily. Alrighty, so now it is time for our main discussion of the evening, and Mr. Highland can tell us about the film.
Yeah.
That
and
dealing with.
Well, I was impressed with the first part of the film. It's, which is of historical nature. It takes place in centuries past.
And the film is called The Church.
Yes. The first part of the film involves the Knights Templar. And I think they're hunting either witches or devil worshippers or something.
Yeah, witches.
Yeah. And they come across a town full of them, and they have to wipe them all out. And what happens after that, they have to bury them. I don't know why they buried them. I mean, they should have just burned them.
Yeah, in a mass grave, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know. I mean, you know, that's kind of stupid because you're supposed to burn witches, but they didn't. They just stuck them in the ground and covered them up.
Yeah. So they buried them, and I think they covered them with lye.
Yep.
Yeah, that's it. Covered them with lye, and then when that's finished, they got a big wooden cross, and they just put it down, and then it embedded itself in the ground.
Yeah. And then, of course, you know, the head of the Knights Templar said, you know, we are going to have to build a church here on top of it to, to hold down the evil. Supposedly.
So it flashes forward to modern times, and of course there's a church.
Big old that Gothic cathedral.
Yeah. Too. And not just that, there's catacombs that are under construction. And so in the midst of all this, there's I guess you can call him a librarian. He has to document and catalog all the books in the church, all the ancient books.
Yeah, and there's the girl who is the one that's doing the restoration on the place.
Yeah. Yeah, but there's a fresco that they're restoring.
Yep.
A big painting. And yeah, I guess you can call this a slow burn because not really much happens aside from the beginning and everything in between. I mean, there's.
Yeah, I mean, besides the librarian getting possessed, that's about it.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, that happens. And then he reaches into his chest and pulls out his heart. I mean, that was a good effect.
Yeah.
I mean, that certainly looked real.
Yeah, it did kind of look real.
Who knows where they got the heart?
Oh, it's a pig heart.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay.
I did a little research on this. Originally, this film was supposed to be part of the Demons series.
Yeah.
And it was scripted by Dario Argento himself.
Yeah.
And Dario even got his dear buddies, the Goblins, to do the incidental music for the film.
Yeah, the music wasn't bad. It's just not up to their usual.
No. Of course, this
standards.
Script was not up to Dario Argento's how good he was at that time, because that was the time when he was also helping George Romero with Dawn of the Dead and that, and he was working on Inferno and Suspiria and those type of films.
No, this is from 89.
Yeah. Oh.
No.
Yeah, it was Inferno then. Yeah, I was working on Inferno at that time.
No, Inferno was earlier.
Oh, it was?
Yeah.
Okay, well, Demons? Demons and Demons 2? I believe. Because as I said, they were going to include this in the Demons series. And they just said, oh, hell no.
Yeah, there really isn't any connection to that, except for the whole witchery kind of thing and possession.
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, people get possessed, but, you know, it doesn't really have too much of a connection to the first two films.
Yeah, what's sad is that it's pretty much the last half hour.
Yeah.
Shit happens. And it's just like all of a sudden, all at one time.
Yeah.
And, you know,
another person gets possessed and people start getting killed. I mean,
yeah, because the church goes into lockdown.
Yeah. Yeah, that happens out of nowhere.
Well, it was because wasn't it Mr. Librarian who goes and tries to break through? There's supposedly something like holy water or something in the cross that's supposed to keep the demons down there, and
I think so.
And he breaks it, and that's what causes the system to start up and close off the church so that the evil can't get out.
Yeah.
Yeah, I love that they had, you know, that they set it up so perfectly that there's this photo shoot for a wedding at that exact time. You know, you got the bitchy bride in that, and she gets her train gets stuck in the door because it closes up behind her. You know, I would have just been cutting that damn dress off of her, you know, rather than, you know, just have her stand there. Oh, we're gonna do it real careful to save your dress. Fuck that. Cut the damn thing off.
And you think that she was going to get killed while pinned to the door, but no, it's someone else. Oh, she's looking for her glasses.
Yeah.
She gets impaled in the neck by can't remember who this person is. One of the people who works at the church.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, he gets possessed and he takes part of a gate or something?
Yeah.
A gated door or something, I don't know what, but he takes it and he rams it into the lady's neck. She gets impaled.
Yeah.
And the lady in the dress, she sees herself in the mirror all ugly and she's clawing at herself and she sees herself as all monstrous.
Yeah, I remember that. There was also this one scene just before everything broke loose that didn't make any sense.
What?
Did you notice that it was the part where this naked woman is in the embrace of a winged demon?
And I remember that. That was quick.
I did a bit of research, and the thing was that it was based on a painting that Dario Argento saw.
Oh.
And he loved it, and he decided to put it into the film. And it was like, okay, it doesn't make sense in the story. God. Damn.
Well, he's probably messing with the viewers.
Yeah, well, you know, that's right up there with him turning Dracula into a bug in his Dracula adaptation. Turning Dracula into a praying mantis. It's like, okay, what the fuck? He wasn't doing too good at that point. That was right up there with his Phantom of the Opera, which I highly do not recommend. Whew. I feel sorry for poor Dario. He's kind of losing it a little bit. Yeah, Dario's daughter's in the film.
Oh, in what role?
She's a little girl.
Oh, okay. Gee, no, well, no wonder she survives.
Yeah.
Yeah, she survives the ordeal.
Yeah, she does until the end.
Yeah, I expected a hand to reach out of that hole that she's looking into, but no, it just ends.
Yeah. Yeah, we were expecting sort of a Carrie thing.
Yeah.
But no, Dario didn't want to do a Carrie thing. Oh well. Carrie did a Carrie thing.
Remember the part where these two people are digging in the ground, are trying to get their way out, and oh, it's the two bikers.
Yeah.
They're digging into the ground and they fall through the floor. They fall through the ground and it's just an abyss. And they're just hanging on, and the girl gets hit by a train. I thought that was rather unintentionally funny.
Yeah.
Now, I don't know if Dario meant it that way or not, but you know, that's what happened.
Yeah, that was just kind of funny.
I mean, does Dario write unintentional humor? Or no?
He does.
Oh, okay. Right.
Oh, my God. You know, his later stuff is just always full of humor, and that's the thing. It's always ridiculously humorous.
Oh.
You're sitting there going, well, we want gore. We want Dario Argento from, intensity from, like Suspiria and that, or, Deep Red or that. And what we get is we get this comedic stuff. I mean, seriously, in his Phantom of the Opera, he has this guy with this steampunk looking drilling device, and it's a midget driving this thing.
And
this horrible special effects on it. And it's like, oh God, please, no. And I paid $12 for that thing. Thankfully, my niece borrowed it and gave it to her friend and got it out of my way. So all I did is lose $12. Didn't have it in my collection to spoil it. But yeah, he started trying to get real funny there, in later years. A lot more humor, because he got tired of being so intense. But this was, this definitely was not the he was trying to be intense in this one, but there was a little bit of the humor that came in. I don't know. All I know is that I've only watched this film twice. When the first time was years ago when it came out at the, I rented it from a video store, and thank God I had five other films with it. And thank God it was on Bargain Wednesday. So it only cost me $3 to rent the film. But yeah, as I said, they've remade this thing, but the remake is really different.
Yeah, I've mentioned this before that it should be remade, but if it was if it was properly remade, the pacing should be, tighter. It should have more gore. It should have just more things going on.
Yeah. Yeah, have James Wan remake it. That would be good. Because he knows pacing. He knows how to put in some scares and add some tension. This was just, I mean, I forgot most of the film right after watching it because it was just boring.
Yeah.
I mean,
this is a movie that I expected more, and it was rather a letdown.
Yeah. Yeah, I like
Michelle Soavi's other work.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know what happened with this one. I just don't know. You know. But, you know, every filmmaker can have duds. And I've known a bunch of filmmakers who have made a whole bunch of duds and then made, you know, one good film. And I've known filmmakers who have made dozens of good films and a couple of duds. You know, I mean, look at Robert Rodriguez. I mean, you wouldn't call Waterboy and Lava Girl.
You mean Shark Boy?
Yeah, Shark Boy and Lava Girl, and the sequel to that as fantastic films.
Well, I wouldn't know. I've never seen them.
God. You know, I mean, this is a guy who did From Dusk Till Dawn. You know, you expect more from him.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, I even like Planet Terror. You know, it wasn't what I expected, but, you know, I enjoyed that. And, it was just right up there with Quentin Tarantino's Death Proof when it came to Grindhouse. You know. But what gets me is it's kind of a thing with these Italian filmmakers, that the older they get, the more films that they make, the more they start falling apart. You know, I mean, it's like what happened with Mario Brava and them. You know, God, I can't even remember the other filmmaker, but his last films were horrid.
Well,
yeah, Mario Brava. Mario Brava.
Bava.
Yeah, Bava.
Well, I remember seeing Mario Bava's last film, and it wasn't bad.
Oh, my God. Egypt Baby?
No, that's not it. It was, I can't remember the title, but it involved a vengeful ghost.
Oh, yeah. Well, yeah, I think I introduced you to that one. Voices from Beyond. Yeah, that one was good. But Egyptian Baby, oh my God. Oh, God. Oh. Oh my God. It's like everyone can tell what film to stop with Mario Brava, because right after that, it's just a bunch of really horrible, I mean, mind-numbing films. And unfortunately, Dario kind of reached that point. You know, I started to notice that with, as I said, with Phantom of the Opera and with the Dracula. You know, if you want to be physically ill, Mr. Highland, at watching a Dracula film, you know, no matter how bad the other films are, Dario fucking blew them all away with his Dracula 3D. That was the title of it, Dracula 3D. I mean, he even miscast Dracula. The guy that he got for Dracula was in no way a Dracula. It was like, what the fuck are you putting this guy in as Dracula? Oh my God. And I actually watched it, and I actually paid good money to see that film. Because I go, oh my God, it's Dario Argento. Oh, I got to see this. And it's like, no, you don't. Now I don't even think about it. I mean, he did do good with his Masters of Horror film that he included with Masters of Horror. That one was actually pretty good. And thankfully, he didn't screw it up. Though, you know, well, he didn't have the budget to do anything else, but he had this scene where this creature was biting off this kid's wanky, and they put this big ass chubby wanky on it. Oh my God. It was like, what the fuck is that? Oh God.
So it was hilarious.
That was, yeah, in a story that was really intense in that. That was one part where I just started laughing and started coughing my head off when I saw it.
Was there a geyser of blood?
Yeah. Yeah. Geyser of blood. And the thing was that, you know, when I got into the making of, they said, oh, yeah. Well, the thing is, we had this leftover penis from this movie that this special effects guy did. It was, believe it or not, Mr. Highland, they used the mold for the penis that they did in Necromantic.
God, how much recycling do horror movies do?
Yeah. And
probably more than people realize, right?
You've seen Necromantic.
Yes, we did a show on those movies.
Yeah, and the penis in that thing was huge. And they're putting this penis on a 12-year-old kid. Yeah. Oh God, that was hilarious. Oh my God.
I'm sure the outtakes are just gold.
Oh my God. And then that's
what needs to be in horror, in the DVDs of horror movies, outtakes.
Yeah.
Never seen them.
And the thing was that the story that Dario Argento did for Masters of Horror, it was based on a comic book thing that he absolutely loved. And it was this thing about this demonic creature that had the body of a beautiful woman and this ugly face. I can't remember the name of it, but they never explained in the comic book where this girl came from, but she was always getting picked up by guys. She would seduce them, and they would end up dying. And Dario came up with this idea. And this shows how bad he had gotten. Instead of it being in a demon, he wanted to make it an alien. And he wanted to show a crotch scene in it. and have this big old alien toothy vagina. And he wasn't able to get the money for it. So he never got to do the crotch shot and it was never even in the comic book or anything.
Oh.
And he came up with the scene of the kid being eaten by her. Because she would eat people. She'd seduce them and then eat them. But the thing was that she wouldn't eat this one guy. But she ate his nephew. That's the kid that she bit off his you know what. And that was eating him. Anyway, so yeah. If you ever get a chance, Mr. Highland, check that one out. It's actually it's the last really good piece of Dario Argento work that I've seen, even with the big ass penis scene. Anyways, yeah, I mean, and as I said, in regard to this film, the church, it would have been totally ridiculous putting it in the demons thing. But the thing was that after Demons 2, they kind of went whack job on that series anyways.
Yeah.
I mean, you look at what they had for Demon 6.
What?
Yeah. Yeah, they did a whole bunch of other Demons films and they had nothing in relation. There was nothing there connecting it to the other ones. It was just that they were using the demon's name. And supposedly there was, Dario helped write the script for Demons 6. And I can't even remember what the creature was. It was a troll. Cave troll. In a castle. Yeah. That was Demon 6. And our dear friend Al Omega showed it on his show. So you can find it, Mr. Highland, and watch it.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it's, you're just sitting there going, what? They think that this was part of Demons? Oh, my flipping God. Thankfully, later on, they just pulled it off the series and gave it its own title. But anyways, so what do you think, Mr. Highland? Have we talked this film out?
Well, I want to say that the big giant body mound that rises up out of the church's floor, I expect, when I saw a picture of that before I watched the movie, I expected more because of that.
Yeah.
But yeah. All those bodies, they don't do anything. It just rises up and then...
Yeah, pretty much.
And then the church starts to, come down. The pillars just knock down that mound. And then, in the midst of all this that's happening, all the death and destruction, there was an old lady who was praying all the time. She occasionally looked up, and she gets knocked down by a pillar falling.
Yep.
What the heck is that about?
Elder abuse, you know, it had to be part of it.
I mean, is that some sort of social commentary by Dario? Yeah.
Probably. You know, it's hard to tell with Dario Argento sometimes. God.
Yeah, this movie needs to be remade properly.
Yeah, it does. Unfortunately, we've got the 2017 version. I think it's 2017 or 2018 version of it, the church. Like, ugh. Yeah, done on a lower budget. Like, ew. Yeah, instead of demons, they had ghosts in that one. Yeah, I know. It's like, no! Nah. I mean, at least this film had atmosphere. The problem was that's all it had.
Mm-hmm.
That was pretty much all it had was atmosphere. Alrighty, so Mr. Highland, you got any idea of what we're going to be doing next month?
Well, given current events, I've had to switch my ideas around. So, in honor of Stuart Gordon, we will be discussing Castle Freak.
Awesome! I love Castle Freak.
Yes, and I remember someone wanted us to discuss that film from one of our fan letters.
Yes, they did! One of our fan letters. And I'm definitely happy about that because, seriously, I mean, I'm a big Castle Freak fan. I even got the action figure.
Oh my!
Yes, they had a Castle Freak action figure that Full Moon put out.
Oh,
yeah,
I didn't know about that.
It has the Castle Freak. It has the torture device, and it has the eaten cat. So pretty good. I mean, the sculpt on the figure looks like crap, though. It's, you know, it's just as bad as the Castle Freak Halloween mask that they put out. You know, with Full Moon, when it comes to their memorabilia, it's you know, give and take. You know, some of their stuff is really good, really good quality. You know, I mean, shoot, I got the pimp doll from Blood Dolls in my collection, believe it or not. Now that's a movie we should definitely do a show on, Mr. Highland.
Oh
yeah, you gotta see Blood Dolls.
Is that another Full Moon or Charles Band?
Yeah, it's a Charles Band one. It's great.
Oh, okay. Who's in it?
God, I can't remember the midget actor. God, I can't remember his name.
Billy Barty?
No, not Billy Barty. He's the one with the beard and the dark long hair in the Charles Band film The Creeps. He played Dracula, and he did a fantastic job as Dracula, I do have to say. But this is one of my favorite ones of him from a Charles Band film, because this is just one of the freakiest ass films you ever wanted to see. And I'm not going to do spoilers because we, you know, Mr. Highland's got to watch it.
Yeah, I haven't seen it yet.
Yeah, you got to see it. It is fucking awesome. It really is. You're going to be going, what the fuck is he making me watch? But you're going to love it. It has a weird charm that just builds up from it. Because it was like, okay, Charlie, were you on acid when you were writing this one? You know. Anyways, yeah, so yeah, I'm very happy. Castle Freak, yeah, next month. Definitely check it out because I got a lot to say about that film. It is fucking awesome. And just remember, full spectrum horror is not for kids. You can fucking count on that. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh, and also YouTube, one more time.
Well, you gotta remind me to not look on YouTube for music.
Oh, well, you know, you'll do it anyways, you know, and I'll just have to use my digital voice recorder to put it up. You know, I was halfway afraid on the one song that you had me do.
The long one?
Yeah. Because commercial.
Well, be thankful I didn't choose the Iron Butterflies in the Gutta Da Vida.
Oh, you don't want to do that. I mean,
oh, of course
I love that song. I love that song, but the thing is that the complete version of it is 20 minutes long.
Oh, I thought it was like 17.
Nope. Okay. I know that song by heart. When I was 7 years old, I knew the lyrics to that film, and I knew the lyrics to that song, and I could sing it. Which is funny because my sister's friends would have me sing it all the time. Whenever they came around. I mean, shit. I had band members. I had Grace Slick coming to our house to do Inagata De Vita. Yeah. Oh my God. Either that or don't Bogart that joint. That was my childhood. They wanted me to sing either Don't Bogart That Joint or Inagata De Vita. So, God, I don't know why they were so sadistic about that. It was like, okay, we want to have a 7-year-old singing Don't Bogart That Joint. And I was the stupid little 7-year-old who actually did it. Yes! And you are getting a little bit more trivia about dear old King of Splatterpunk, William Pattison, here. Okay. Alrighty, so, you know, that's it for the show. You know, any last minute, any, you know, last words, Mr. Highland?
Yes, I would like to thank our listeners for tuning in and tune in next time for Castle Freak. And if you have any requests for film discussions, or if or any guests you want to try and get, you know, write in and we'll see what we can do.
Hell yeah, we'll see what we can do. The thing is, you know, right now, you know, this is the best time because everyone's you know, stuck at home.
Yeah.
So, you know, we could, you know, we've got a lot of bored celebrities out there who are looking for something to do. You know.
Yeah, it's just a matter of getting in contact with them.
Yeah.
Getting in contact with them, getting them to agree to appear on the show.
You know, yeah, because a lot of them, what the thing is that they want cash. You know, well, how much money are you willing to pay me? It's like, no. We don't get paid. You don't get paid. You want us to promote you? That's fine. But no, we don't pay. Well, then you don't get me because I'm a big star. Well, yeah, you're a big jackass too. So there. Okay. Anyways. Alrighty. So as always, people, that's our show. Keep America strong. Watch horror films. And we'll catch you next month.
The love that you bring me along. The pain that you give, gives me a home. Do you wanna stay by my side? Do you want me to turn it on? Disappearing inside, seeing pictures of our goodbyes. We believe that our love will survive the pain that you bring. Brings me all alone. Disappointment down. I wanna repress your goodbye, goodbye. The design, we brought them all. The dreams when you see that goodbyes are for long. Please follow me to the borders of destiny. Design, we brought them all. The dreams. design. We broke the mold. The dreams when you see that goodbye soon flown.
The internet.